Hi, Charles. It's a pleasure to have you here at our Tel Aviv Endor office. And I wanted to have a nice, friendly chat about our recent development, share some information, and ask you about your views about decentralization and so on. So glad to have you with us.
Oh, it's wonderful to be here. Tel Aviv is such a beautiful city and the weather is perfect.
Yeah, it is. So maybe I'll just jump right into the main question I want to ask you. You're trying to decentralize the world. We are in the business of decentralizing AI. Can you share with us a little bit about your views regarding decentralization, the roadmap, where do you see the world advance, and so on?
So if we look at the evolution of the IT industry, it started by saying, hey, we can create software and we can run that software on computers. And oh, wow, that software can actually be modeled to reflect business stuff. And then suddenly you could solve new problems or old problems much more efficiently. And people started building these beautiful cathedral-like hierarchies, these nice silos where they would explore all kinds of things. And then this connecting tissue started emerging and software companies started coming out, and then the internet came out and SaaS products came out. And we now live in a global world. And that global world offers us the ability to do miracles that 50 years ago, 60 years ago, if you were a business professional, you wouldn't be able to do, whether that be communicating with people all across the world real time. IOHK is a global company. We're in 20 countries, from Argentina to Japan. We're in 9 time zones. And yet I can communicate with everybody, no matter where I'm at, as if I'm right next to them. That's very powerful. But there is another issue with the way this momentum has been pushing, in that these systems have introduced many middlemen. So there's people who produce things, people who consume things, and then there's these companies that live in between, or infrastructure or software that lives in between. That can be payment systems, that can be Uber, that can be Airbnb, all of those types of things. And the problem with these middlemen is they are middlemen of necessity. They're not middlemen of desire. And as a consequence, they take value out of the transaction, they aggregate large amounts of data, they do whatever they need to do for their particular business model. And over time, they become so powerful that instead of just being a facilitator of an interaction or a marketplace or a business process, in many cases, they can mandate how that entire business needs to run. And so when we look at that on the corporate side, it's concerning. When we look at it on the government side, it's dystopian. And so we say, perhaps there's a better way for us to globalize and enjoy the miracles of the ICT revolution, but do this in a way where we can retain some of our privacy, retain some of our autonomy, and also we're in charge ultimately of the way we want to do business, how we want to do business, who we want to do business with. So let's go from the broad philosophical to the general and move into the particular. So Endor is a really cool and interesting product, and I'm glad to be working with you guys. So let's talk about your experiences. You've just launched like a major milestone for the Endor project. Let's get into that.
Yeah. So as you know, the Endor protocol is based on the technology of social physics that we developed for several years at MIT. And one of the main advantages of social physics is its ability to analyze encrypted data. So for the first time, and this resonates perfectly with some of the things you've mentioned earlier, for the first time we can allow data owners to onboard their data to an open protocol that can absorb data that is plugged in, so to speak, in a completely encrypted way, meaning that it can now be queried or it can use as a basis for prediction by the data owners themselves or third parties that are interested in using this data, either for commercial purposes or other purposes. And now, not only that the data itself is kept private, but the questions that are asked are also kept private. You don't need to disclose what your intention is when you use the system. And this again resonates with some of the things you said before. The first generation of machine learning algorithms required you to assume that you know pretty well what the questions are going to be, because you are featureizing the data and the features that you select are chosen so they would fit the questions that are going to be asked. And this, of course, is highly related to the data sanitation that you have to do at the first phase. So you spend a lot of, you used to spend a lot of time cleaning the data, featureizing it, and then you train the model for a specific question. And we decided to take a different path and allow data to be projected into the so to speak social physics space, which is basically a mathematical representation of behavioral commonalities among the users or objects that are the source of this data. And what this allows is the ability to ask any questions at the second phase. You're no longer bound to knowing a priori what the questions are going to be. You can take data, you can transform it into a canonic representation that the Endor Open Protocol supports, and then you can ask any prediction, exactly the kind of examples that you gave. Which coupon is going to be most effective? Who is going to take a loan? Where the next traffic jam is going to occur? Whatever you want to know, you can ask, and you do not need to disclose the semantics of your questions. Using the Endor protocol, you can query data. You don't know who provided the data. You don't know who owns the data. You don't disclose your questions. Everything is kept private, and you can still get very accurate results. Now, in order to get those very accurate results, you pay. You pay with the EDR token, that is the basis of the Endor protocol. And the EDR token is the incentive for the data providers, the data owners, to onboard their data. So basically what you get here is a very nice network effect, right, whereas if you have valuable data, you can project it to the social physics space using the Endor protocol. You sort of onboard it to this big cloud of encrypted data. And from this point on, you start getting passive income in the form of EDR tokens whenever it is used for predictions.
But this only works if there's scale. So you need to have lots and lots and lots of data. And you know, I recently visited the country of Georgia, and one of the most profound things to see, if you ever have time, is Bitfury's facility. They have these huge mining facilities. And that's just a great example of economic incentives creating something gargantuan. So if you think about mining, this is just a process where they say, if you do something, you get X. And because this becomes more valuable over time, more and more people do it. And then eventually you see these gigantic warehouses filled with specialized hardware and subsidized power to get it done. So similarly, if such a system as Endor is to work, then it needs to have an incentive system behind it for data to be put into the system and for data to be consumed. So can you talk a bit about the token itself and the utility and these mm-hmm. incentives that mm-hmm. exist?
Yes, you're perfectly right. In order for the open protocol to work, we need as many data providers to onboard their high quality data and make it available for questions. So the way to achieve it, as you said, is the use of the EDR token. And the EDR token is a utility token that allows you to pay for predictions. You pay for predictions that are being answered by data that was onboarded to the system. So if I am a data owner and I want my data to be onboarded to the system, I contribute my data and I need to pay. I need to pay an initial fee in EDR tokens to have my data being processed. Because this first phase of detecting all those pebbles takes time, it requires computational power, and the tokens that I pay go for the providers of this computational power. I would then be given back my initial payment or deposit, if you will, when my data is actually being used. And this is done to prevent data owners from just flooding the system with junk random data. So you need to onboard only data that you have good reasons to assume has good value. So you pay the initial deposit that is funding the initial processing, then the data basically get registered in the protocol, and people can use it in order to ask questions. Now, the way this is done is also fully automatic. I do not expect someone that has questions to know exactly which data is going to be best useful to answer the question. Similarly to the internet, when you want to access some information, you do not need to provide the best route of your IP packets, right? You just say, I want to access this address, and then the internet magically gives you the information. So with the Endor protocol, this is similar. Whenever a question is being asked, the protocol takes all the clusters, all the behavioral commonalities that we just discussed that are of the type of the question. So if we're asking about locations, all the behavioral clusters that were derived from data that has locations, if you're talking about emails, whatever, every data that is associated with this type of object, it gathers all the clusters and then extracts the result, the best prediction that it can generate. And then the Endo protocol also can attribute to the data that took part in this calculation exactly which portion of the prediction was attributed to each data origin. And the way this is done is, again, because we're talking about clusters. If I derived 20 million clusters, behavioral clusters, from data source A, and another 5 million from data source B, but my question actually used 80% of the clusters that were used to answer my question came from data source B, then the owner of data source B would be given 80% from the tokens that I paid for my question.
That's pretty fascinating. So let's talk about use cases. So who's actually using the protocol right now?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so we just recently launched the first version of the protocol, and it's already being used by a variety of users. Let's go from large to small. Largest are governments. We are already working with several governments who benefit from the ability of the Endo protocol to analyze encrypted data. This allows them the ability to use it on data that would be very problematic to share outside a very siloed, privately kept data facility. And furthermore, they utilize the ability of the protocol to ask questions without disclosing the question itself. So several governments are already working, have done a successful POCs, and are now discussing a more strategic deals. This is the largest. Smaller than this, we have big banks. We cannot, due to, of course, a commercial consideration, we cannot disclose the information, but I can give maybe a couple of examples. There is a large bank in South America that has deployed the Endor protocol in several countries. So several countries that this bank is working in has dozens of business stakeholders using the Endo protocol on a daily basis. And they ask questions about their users, who is going to take a loan, who is going to do various things that we do not even know what they're looking for. And the questions are being answered by the bank's own data, because the protocol allows you to flag your data as completely private, which means that only you would be given access to it. Nobody else would be given access to it. Of course, you would not be able to benefit from your data, but you can still use it and generate commercial revenue by getting insights from your own data. So this is one example. And the second is MetLife. MetLife is one of the world's largest insurance company. They are very innovative. They are in fact now looking how to completely disrupt the insurance business. And we have just recently, just last week, won the MetLife Innovation Challenge. Actually, 200 participants from 30 different countries applied, and we won first place, and we're now discussing a more strategic partnership that would allow MetLife to use the Endor protocol in order to analyze all the data that they have access to and generate automatic predictions. Smaller than this, we have SMBs. And unlike banks, unlike companies that we also work with, like MasterCard and Coca-Cola, that can afford to build big teams of data scientists, sure, it would be very expensive and it would be very limited, but they can afford to form these teams. SMBs cannot. SMBs, until today, had an entry barrier that was like a glass ceiling. If you cannot spend several million dollars building a team of 3 to 10 data scientists, how can you optimize your marketing campaigns? You cannot. And with the Endo protocol, we already work with several SMBs that can analyze their data or public data sets that we support with the Endo protocol in order to ask predictive questions. I can give one example. It's a company called AlgoWave. And AlgoWave is a B2C company working in the cryptocurrency space. And they use the Endo protocol in order to analyze the ERC20 blockchain itself and offer prediction to their own users. Predictions such as which token is going to go up, which token is going to go down.
And did they have a track record? Was there anything interesting there?
Yes, it's actually been working in production for over 5 months. And they have just recently published the summary of the results, and it's actually very exciting. And you don't need them to publish the result because it's the blockchain. You can see that thousands of people purchased predictions, paid with the EDR tokens, got the predictions, and half of them became recurring customers. So apparently, they were happy with the predictions. They came back for more.
Beautiful. It's a very exciting project, and I love being a part of it. It's nice to see a blending of hardcore academic work that took years to get done properly to solve a very real problem that is having a dramatic impact on the world. And if we get the design right to see how this can, just like mining, scale to eventually millions in different places all across the world and create an internet of predictions. So
yes.
Thank you so much for taking
the
time.
Thank you for visiting us.
Of course.